Now, let's move to the third part, off-policy actor critic. So far, the actor critic and policy gradient algorithms that we have discussed are all on policy. What if we have some experience samples and want to make use of them? In that case, we can use the off-policy actor-critic algorithm. Before introducing the algorithm, I must introduce an important technique called importance sampling, which can be used to transform an on-policy algorithm into an off-policy one. The policy gradient and actor-critic algorithms we discussed earlier are all on policy. Why? The fundamental reason is that the gradient equals an expectation, and within that expectation, A must follow the policy pi. This means that when we sample, A must be sampled according to pi, so pi is a behavior policy. At the same time, pi is also the policy we want to update, so it is also the target policy. Since both policies are the same, the algorithm is on policy. Now, the question is, can we transform this into an off-policy algorithm? The answer is yes. We can convert it into an off-policy algorithm by using the importance sampling technique. It is important to note that although importance sampling is introduced in this lecture, it is not limited to the actor-critic method. In fact, any algorithm that requires calculating an expectation can be combined with importance sampling. This includes methods like Monte Carlo or temporal difference methods. First of all, let's consider some intuitive examples. Consider a simple scenario with a random variable x, which belongs to a set of two elements, positive 1 and negative 1. If the distribution of x is p0, then the probability of x equals 1 is 0.5, and the probability of x equals negative 1 is also 0.5. In this case, what is the expectation of x? It would be positive 1 times 0.5 plus negative 1 times 0.5, which equals 0. This is very simple. Now, consider the scenario where we do not know the explicit form of P0 or P0 is too complex to calculate. In such cases, we are unable to compute the expectation EX by its definition. Then, can we estimate it through sampling? Here, we consider two cases. The first case is one we are already familiar with. We discussed it when introducing the Monte Carlo method. Let's quickly revisit this case. Suppose that we have some samples, and these samples are obtained based on P0, which is the true distribution of x. Then, each sample's expectation will be equal to Ex, and its variance will be the same as the variance of x. In this case, we can use the average value of the samples to approximate the expectation. Specifically, by summing all the samples and then averaging them, we get x bar, which can approximate Ex. Moreover, as the number of samples increases, this approximation becomes more accurate. That is because x bar is an unbiased estimate of Ex, and its variance is the variance of x divided by n. As n tends to infinity, the variance approaches zero. This is by the law of large numbers. For more details, you can refer to my book or check the Monte Carlo lecture. This diagram, which we also discussed in the Monte Carlo lecture, illustrates the idea. When I have positive 1 and negative 1, with probabilities of 0.5 each, and I take 200 random samples, I will get approximately 100 samples of positive 1 and 100 samples of negative 1. After averaging, you can see that initially the estimate is not very accurate, but over time it gradually approaches the true expectation, which in this case is 0. Now, let's consider the second case, which is a new case that we want to study. In this case, we have some samples, but these samples are not generated according to the P0 distribution. Instead, they are generated according to a different distribution, P1. For example, suppose P1 has a probability of 0.8 for x equals positive 1 and 0.2 for x equals negative 1. Since x follows P1, the expected value is positive 1 times 0.8 plus negative 1 times 0.2 equals 0.6. Recall that when x follows P0, the expectation is 0. Clearly, these expected values are different. So, naturally, since the samples are generated according to P1, the average of the samples, x bar, will tend towards the expectation of x under P1, which is 0.6. This is different from the expectation under P0, which is 0. So, what is our goal here? Suppose that I generated some samples from distribution P1. Our goal is to use these samples to estimate the expectation under P0. Why do we want to do this? The answer is quite simple. We want to perform off-policy learning. In off-policy learning, there is a behavior policy, beta, which in this case corresponds to P1. This is the policy that generates the data. We also have a target policy, pi, which is the policy under which we want to estimate the expectation. In this context, pi corresponds to P0. Then, how can we achieve that goal? As we have seen earlier, if we simply average the samples, the result will converge to the expectation under P1, not P0. Therefore, we need to use an important technique called importance sampling. Let's take a look at an intuitive example before we go into the details. As we remember, when x equals positive 1, the probability under P1 is 0.8, and when x equals negative 1, the probability is 0.2. So, if we perform 200 samples, we can clearly see that the number of samples of positive 1 is much larger than the number of samples of negative 1. Here, the dashed line represents x bar, the average of these samples. Without surprise, the average converges to 0.6, which is the expectation under P1. What does the red line represent? It is the result when we apply the importance sampling technique to the same samples. With this technique, the result will converge to the expectation under P0, which is 0. Now, let me introduce the importance sampling technique. The following equation is crucial. Pay attention to this. This represents the final goal we aim to achieve, which is the expectation of x. X follows the distribution P0. By the definition of expectation, it equals the sum over all x of x multiplied by its probability. It does not change when we add P1x on both the numerator and denominator. Then, I can write this term, which is P0x divided by P1x and multiplied by x, as a larger function fx. Then, it can also be written in the form of an expectation. It's the expectation of fx, and here x follows P1. This equation is important because it allows us to approximate the original expectation by using the expectation of fx, where x follows P1. Since the samples are generated according to P1, we can use these samples to approximate the expectation of fx. This is the core idea behind importance sampling. Next, how to compute the right-hand side? It's quite simple. Since our samples are generated according to P1, we can calculate fxi for each sample xi, then sum them up and take the average. This average is denoted as f bar. Clearly, the expectation of f bar is equal to the expectation of fx, and its variance is equal to the variance of fx divided by n. This is by the law of large numbers, which we have discussed many times before. Thus, this average can be used to approximate this value, and this value is equal to this one. Let's see this equation again. What we want is the expectation of x, where x follows the distribution P0. Then, I approximate it using f bar, which equals the average. Substituting the expression for fx into it can lead to this equation. If you look at this equation, you'll see that it is actually a weighted average. I'm still averaging over xi, but there's a weight, which is p0xi divided by p1xi. This weight is called the importance weight. If p1 equals p0, then this division becomes 1. So in that case, f bar and x bar are exactly the same. If p0 is greater than p1, for example, at xi, the weight becomes greater than 1. Why is this weight reasonable here? Let me give an intuitive explanation. Suppose I have a sample xi. On the one hand, p0xi is large, meaning that the probability of sampling xi under p0 is high. On the other hand, p1xi is small, meaning that xi can be rarely sampled under p1. Then, since I am trying to calculate the expectation under p0, I should give extra importance to this xi because it's rare under p1 but easy to sample under p0. Therefore, the weight is greater than 1, indicating that xi has a higher importance weight. This is an intuitive explanation. Some of you may have a question. That is, when we calculate f bar, the numerator is p0xi. So we need to know the distribution of xi. You may ask, if I know p0, why don't I just sum p0x over all x to compute the expectation by definition? Why bother using importance sampling? This is a good question, often asked by beginners. The answer is quite simple. If we could do that, we wouldn't need importance sampling. The reason we need to use importance sampling is because we are not able to do that. More specifically, we may know P0x for given x, but we cannot directly compute its expectation by definition. Let me give examples to clarify. First, although we're dealing with discrete cases, there also exist continuous cases. When x is continuous, we have to calculate the integral instead of summation. Then we need the expression of P0. Although we can know the probability of a given value, x, we may not know the probability of all values or the explicit expression of P0. Hence, we are not able to compute the integral. More importantly, P0 may be represented by a neural network. In this case, given a specific x, I can obtain P0x, but there is no explicit expression of P0. This is the reason why we need to use importance sampling. You may ask, when would we use a neural network to represent a distribution? In reinforcement learning, the policy pi AS theta is usually represented as a neural network, where theta represents the parameters of the network. Given a state S and an action A, this neural network can output the corresponding probability. Let me summarize what we've discussed just now. We have a set of samples, and these samples are generated according to the distribution P1. Two quantities are involved here. The first quantity is x bar, which is the average of all the samples. When the number of samples is large, what does it converge to? It will converge to the expectation of x, but with the distribution as P1. This is simple. However, our goal here is to find the expectation under P0, so what do we do? We use the second quantity, which is f bar, to do this. F bar is a weighted average. We have seen this figure before. Now let me use it to explain these two expressions. For P1, the probability of getting 1 is 0.8, and the probability of getting negative 1 is 0.2. I have 200 samples. As you can see, the number of samples of 1 is much higher because its probability is greater, while the number of samples of negative 1 is much fewer. When I directly compute the average of these samples, I get the blue line, which corresponds to x bar. If I perform a weighted average, I get the red line, which corresponds to f bar. You can see that x bar converges to about 0.6, while f bar converges to a value near 0. Furthermore, we can apply the importance sampling technique to policy gradient to perform off-policy learning. There are actually two steps involved. The first step is to derive the expression for the gradient. Once we have the gradient, we can apply gradient-based algorithms to do optimization. Now, let's see what the gradient looks like. Suppose that beta is the behavior policy used to generate experience samples. Our goal is to optimize the objective function j theta, where theta is the parameter of the target policy pi. What is j theta defined as? It is d beta s times v pi s, summed over all states s. Here, d beta s is the stationary distribution under policy beta, and v pi s is the state value under policy pi. The gradient corresponding to this objective function is given as this. Here I provide the result with proof, and you can refer to my book for the proof. In this expression, on the left side is the gradient, and on the right side is the expectation. The distribution for s is rho, and the distribution for a is beta. It is notable that in the on-policy case, action A follows the probability distribution pi. However, in the off-policy case, action A follows the probability distribution beta. The term inside the brackets is the same as in the on-policy case, except that it is now multiplied by a weight factor. The weight here is actually the importance sampling weight. Recall that we use P0 and P1 to denote two distributions. Now pi corresponds to P0 and beta corresponds to P1. This is because P0 is the distribution under which we want to estimate the expectation, and the samples we have are generated according to P1. With the expression of the gradient, we can apply a gradient ascent method to optimize the objective function. First, we can also add a baseline without changing the gradient here. That is to add the baseline here. We usually set the baseline as the state value v pi s. The true gradient contained an expectation. Since we don't know it, we use a stochastic gradient to approximate it. This is the off-policy policy gradient algorithm, and it is similar to what we saw in A2C. Here, we have QT minus VT, and we replace it with the expression RT plus 1 plus gamma VTST plus 1 minus VTST, and this is the TD error. This can also be interpreted as the advantage function. With this, the algorithm becomes the one shown. Here, delta represents this. Next is the pseudocode, but before that, I want to mention that we can transform the expression of the algorithm a little. The gradient of log pi equals the gradient of pi divided by pi. When we cancel out the pi terms, we are left with delta in the numerator and beta in the denominator. Here we have the gradient of pi, and this corresponds to the step size. We have already discussed similar expressions like this in previous lectures. When delta is large, the next step is to increase the probability pi ATST, making it more likely to choose that action. This can enhance the action's probability. Previously, we had pi in the denominator. When pi ATST is small, the next step will increase it. This mechanism was explained earlier. However, instead of pi, we have beta here. Therefore, there's no exploration, and it only has exploitation, as the denominator is given. The pseudocode is given here. It is actually identical to the earlier A2C algorithm. The only difference is the inclusion of the behavior policy beta. Generating experience samples is based on this policy beta. The remaining parts of the algorithm are the same, except for the addition of the two importance weights. Since this is very similar to the previous algorithm, I will not go over it in detail again.